of the Estonian authorities.
At the invitation of the Estonian authorities. On behalf of the military committee, I want to thank our hosts for the incredibly warm welcome and the generous hospitality they have shown us since our arrival. It is great to see, feel, and experience firsthand the enduring spirit of the Estonian people. The reverence for your history and the memory of those who have fought and died in the name of peace, freedom, and democracy is omnipresent. Estonia is a country that has resilience in its DNA. In fact, it is enshrined in your constitution that every citizen has a right and a duty to defend the independence of its nation. Estonia has not forgotten its past, but it is also fully embracing the future. As a digital republic, Estonia leads the way in cyber resilience and comprehensive governmental online services. The Alliance greatly benefits from Estonia's expertise in information sharing, utilizing freedom of navigation in the information domain, connecting systems, adapting in order to enable online as well as offline resilience. Our Alliance is living proof that adaptation is never done. We have been doing so continuously for the last 73 years, and we will continue to do so together, whatever the circumstances might be. This conference comes at a time where global security is under immense pressure. Russia's unprovoked war against Ukraine has ushered us into a new era for global security. We are all in awe of the immense courage of the Ukrainian armed forces and the Ukrainian people, who outmaneuver their opponent time and time again. NATO allies will support them for as long as it takes. Winter is coming, but our support shall remain unwavering. It is crystal clear in that this conflict is bigger than Ukraine. The entire international rules-based order is under attack. This, as well as terrorist groups who use asymmetric warfare and create local as well as global disruptions, and China's immense military buildup and dangerous rhetoric looms over all of us. NATO has a sacred task to protect the 1 billion citizens who live on allied soil, to always plan and think ahead, be ready to expect the unexpected. This is what NATO's highest military authority will do throughout our sessions today. For the first time in the history of the military committee, the chiefs of defense of Finland and Sweden will join us as NATO invitees. General Timo Kivinen and General Mikael Biden, we are proud to have you in our midst. And we look forward to welcoming you to our alliance in the near future. Furthermore, I'm pleased to also welcome three new allied chiefs of defense, Brigadier General Arben Kingji from Albania, Major General Karl Jaka from the Czech Republic, and then Brigadier General Zoran Lasaravic from Montenegro. We also be supported in our deliberations by the newly installed Supreme Allied Commander Europe, General Christopher Cavoli, and the Director General of the International Military Staff, General Janusz Adamczak. We look forward to hearing your contributions and advice. We all have an immense task ahead of us. Today, we will discuss how to implement the far-reaching decisions taken on NATO's deterrence and defense posture by our political leadership at NATO Summit in Madrid, and how to operationalize NATO's deter and defend strategy. Supreme Allied Commander Europe, General Cavoli, will provide us with his strategic considerations on our current and future posture on the eastern flank and across the whole spectrum of our 360-degree approach to security. The Chiefs of Defense will discuss NATO's ongoing operations, missions, and activities, including the NATO Mission Iraq and Kosovo Force. As stewards of the military profession, we will also look at the future of our forces by dedicating a special session today to diversity and how it can help shape our future forces and increase our innovative capacity. Supreme Allied Commander Transformation, General Lavigne, will provide us with the insights on how we can promote cooperation across domains and service branches, and how we can transform our armed forces in the digital era. Ladies and gentlemen, NATO is built on the promise of solidarity, but that promise would be empty if there was nobody willing to fight for it. Every minute of every day, our 3.2 million, soon to be more, men and women in uniform show us what that solidarity means in practice. The sacrifices it takes, the opportunities it brings, and most of all, the immense importance of being in a band of brothers and sisters, the biggest in the world. On behalf of the Military Committee, I want to express our deep gratitude and respect for the men and women who serve our alliance. We thank them for their courage, their professionalism, and their dedication. I would like to now take a moment to remember the men and women who paid the ultimate price for our freedom, and all those who are dealing with the physical and mental effects of their time in service. We honor their sacrifice. Please stand. Thank you. Now I would like to hand the floor to Lieutenant General Herem for his opening remarks. Martin, the floor is yours.
Prime Minister, Mr. Chair, dear friends and colleagues, it is my pleasure and honor to host you all here in Tallinn. Tere tulemast. A warm welcome also to our friends and neighbors, Timo and Michael. I'm looking forward to your full accession to the NATO club. And the Baltic region and the Alliance as whole will only gain from it. A year ago, we gathered in a sunny Athens. This MCC brings you to NATO's front line. What better place than Tallinn, just under 200 kilometers away from Russian border, to discuss major disruptions that have taken place in our strategic environment since Athens. By the way, on this day, 83 years ago, on September 17th in 1939, the Soviet Union invaded to and occupied the eastern Poland. During next year, Baltics lost independence and Finland lost some territories. In 2022, the Euro-Atlantic area is again not at peace, as it is also stated in the new strategic concept. Allied heads and states and governments agreed in Madrid that the Russian Federation is the most significant and direct threat to Allied security. War on the European continent has been going on actually for 8 years. The latest Russian aggression against Ukraine has already lasted for 7 months. Our most urgent task continues to be the support to Ukraine. If we want to preserve the world order as we know it, Ukraine must win. As chiefs of defense, we must push for significant and continuous military assistance, either in form of material support, training, or other relevant help. We have all realized that this is not a sprint, it is a marathon. Here in Estonia, the war in Ukraine feels very close. It is not a theoretical issue, neither for our population nor for the armed forces. When Estonians see the war images pouring out of Ukraine, they see that we could be in their place. In Estonia, ordinary citizens discuss over dinner how to organize their life and work in case of aggression. More and more people are signing up to the Voluntary Defense League, so they would contribute one way or another to statewide national defense effort. Therefore, personally, I very much feel the weight of today's crisis and the responsibility. Both as a nation and as an alliance, we are at the crossroad. Our future is being shaped right now. Today, every delayed decision, a decision not taken, or a delayed funding could be crucial. A war is ongoing just behind the border of four NATO member states. We need to push ahead urgently with the implementation of Madrid Summit decisions and strengthen considerably NATO's deterrence and defense posture. Heads of states and governments have agreed that we need to move away from the previous tripwire approach to forward defense. Now it is up to us, the armed forces of the alliance, to rapidly translate this new concept into concrete military actions. We have already started laying the necessary foundations for a stronger and more capable NATO. DDA's family of plans linked to designated and ready forces, clear C2 supported by robust digital backbone, must produce executable defense solutions as soon as possible. In addition to work done by NATO headquarters, key here is held in capitals. Plans without real forces will just be a pile of paper. Therefore, nations should take a proactive stance to fill the new force model with required forces and capabilities. However, the current security environment requires a stronger sense of urgency. We need practical outcomes, and we need them now. We cannot allow to stuck in the planning cycles created for different times or old habits. Individually and in cooperation with allies, we should be looking for bottom-up solutions to create faster the required conditions for NATO activities and plans. In addition to new solutions, I'm also happy to see some old solutions making their way back. With the accession of Finland and Sweden, the number of NATO countries using conscription and reserve army model will increase. To generate sufficient resources and stronger relationship between armed forces and the society, this model continues to be prove its value. Of course, current strategic competition is not limited to Europe. The West, in its broad sense, is more and more challenged globally. China uses today's momentum of instability to test the limits and to challenge our interests. Terrorism, in all its forms, continues to be the most direct asymmetric threat to the security of our citizens. Conflict, fragility, and instability in NATO's southern neighborhood directly affect our own security. Western Balkans seem to be becoming a testbed for all kinds of hybrid warfare tactics. Race to influence and resources in Africa and in the Arctic are supplementary lines of effort for our opponents. In addition, we must realize that instability does not always happen naturally. We see Russian helping hand across different continents. So, of course, as an alliance of 30 nations, or soon 32 nations, we cannot afford to be a single topic organization. However, before getting into fancy home improvement, we must put out the fire first. Russia cannot be allowed to change by force the current international order. Last but not least, let me thank the entire NATO team for their excellent cooperation and all the Estonians who have put countless hours into making the NATO Military Committee conference in Tallinn a success. I wish you a pleasant and interesting stay in Tallinn. Thank you.
Martin, thank you very much. Prime Minister, it's an honor for us to have you here, so I'm more than happy to hand the floor to you, Her Excellency, Madam Kaja Kallas, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Your Excellencies. It is my great pleasure to welcome you here in Tallinn. This means a lot to us, and I don't think we have seen so many military leaders here before. At least I haven't. I particularly welcome the Chiefs of Defense of Finland and Sweden. Tervetuloa, willkommen. For years, your forces have been training together with NATO forces and participating in crisis management operations. I hope for a swift military integration in the near future, and I don't think it's going to be really difficult. We just need the political decisions to be taken. Your accession to NATO will be an important contribution to the security of the whole Euro-Atlantic area. I would also like to take a moment to honor the late Queen Elizabeth II, whose wisdom and remarkable duty provided stability for 70 years. Her Majesty's Armed Forces have been leading the enhanced forward presence here in Tapa since 2017. So thank you for that. We will be forever grateful for the UK's presence in Estonia. On the 24th of February, Europe entered a new security reality. Russia's genocidal war against Ukraine, right on NATO's doorstep, is the most serious security crisis of our generation. When it was a surprise to many, it wasn't a surprise to us. In response, NATO has made a shift in mindset. At the Madrid summit, allies defined the Russian Federation as the most significant and direct threat to NATO's security. Russia's aggression is a colossal strategic error, as the spirit of Ukrainian population and its military cannot be broken. The recent operational defeat in Russia in the Kharkiv Oblast is a sign of Ukrainian grit and astuteness. It shows the effectiveness of Western aid and advice. The Kremlin's tactics against the West has a focus to force us to negotiate. The Kremlin uses energy to blackmail us. They have admitted that they want to make Europe freeze. They have threatened with global famine. They have threatened with nuclear disasters. They use the old Soviet negotiation tactics. First, you demand something that has never been yours. Second, you present threats, ultimatums. You terrorize the people and the leaders. And then, do not give one inch in negotiations, because there will always be people in the West who will offer you something that you didn't have before. So in the end, you will have one third or even half of something you didn't have. Let's not give them that. This is why we cannot give in one inch, and we must be prepared to be in it for the long haul. What we see in Izum is that under occupied territories, even if there is peace, the human suffering will continue. This is also the history of Estonia. While there was peace and many closed their eyes and ears, what was happening here, the tortures, the sufferings of our people continued. Our people were deported, Russian people were imported. If we do not counter Russian aggression and expansionism decisively, the whole international rules-based order will be under threat. This means that no country and no nation could feel safe. If aggression pays off somewhere, it serves as an invitation to use it elsewhere. Impunity may encourage other authoritarian leaders. Putin and all of those who have committed war crimes have to know that their judgment day will come. Legal consequences have to follow. When we have agreed in the international law that it is illegal to occupy or threaten or go against another sovereign state, then when somebody does that, there have to be legal consequences for that. While we are very focused on the conventional war that is going on in Ukraine right now, we must not forget there is also a hybrid war and information war going on. No ally has remained unaffected by intensified hybrid warfare. We have seen an increase of disinformation campaigns and cyber attacks against Estonia and our allies. These unfriendly activities below the threshold require our daily attention. The alliance is not at war, but we are living in a time of war, and we must adapt accordingly. Putin expects us, our unity to fall apart over the hard winter. He thinks that the West and the Western people are weak, that we can't survive their threats, and we can't survive the hard winter. We cannot allow this to happen. Over the last year, I've advocated for a long-term policy of smart containment towards Russia. This means four things. First, we have been on the right track by directly supporting Ukraine. The ongoing counter-offensive proves that military aid takes Ukraine closer to victory and peace. Our focus must be scaling up our aid and weapons deliveries to push back the Russian aggression as soon as possible. Estonia itself has contributed up to 0.8% of our GDP to assisting Ukraine and will continue to provide training to Ukrainian soldiers for as long as it takes. Ukraine has not the war until they say that they have won it. And like we reaffirmed in Madrid, NATO's door should remain open for European democracies who share the values of the alliance. If we wouldn't be members of NATO right now, I think Estonia would be living through some very, very difficult and dark times. Second, Russia has to be held accountable for their war of aggression, aggression crimes, and war crimes. We need to ensure that the perpetrators will be prosecuted. Third, we need to raise the cost of aggression. We have witnessed an era of tremendous change, historic support to Ukraine, huge sanctions, increases in defense spending, NATO's new defense posture. We must collectively continue to tighten sanctions and isolate Russia internationally. The EU has adopted a seventh package of sanctions on Russia. However, Russia continues to gain benefits from oil and gas sales. We must remind ourselves that fossil fuels exports are the key enabler of Russia's war fighting in Ukraine. An army without supplies and low on morale cannot fight for long. It is also clear that it is not Putin's war, but actually the war of Russian people. The war is hugely supported in Russian population. Therefore, we should use all the tools in the toolbox to actually pressure Ukraine, Russia into ending the war. And they can easily go back to their borders and the war is over. That's why we have also advocated for a tourist visa ban. And that is because only 30% of Russian people, citizens, have international passports, and they come from the Moscovite and St. Petersburg elites. This means that they also have the possibility to pressure Kremlin into some other decisions if they feel this war affecting their everyday lives. We must move forward with these significant policy shifts until Russia will change its course. And fourth, and this is important, especially important to us, that NATO's new defense posture must remain ironclad. In Madrid, the alliance decided to significantly strengthen its defense and deterrence in the eastern flank. We have started this work and expect a significant progress to be made before the next summit in Vilnius. Adaptation towards forward defense posture for us in Estonia means, first of all, that we need to increase our readiness. Since January, we have made significant investments to increase our ammunition stocks, improve existing capabilities, and develop new ones, upgrade infrastructure to host allies, and also expand training areas. In addition, we are establishing a new divisional structure, which will create better conditions for a possible NATO's response in our region. And this is all for it never be needed or actually put in practice. To achieve that, we have raised Estonia's defense spending up to 2.5% for the next year. And actually, yesterday, we made decisions for the upcoming 4 years to increase it even further up to 3% of our GDP. We also expect to see practical steps taken at NATO to implement new forward defense posture. This means having executable NATO defense plans in place and exercised. This means a stronger NATO's posture in the land, sea, and air domains to deny any aggression against its territory. Estonia fully supports NATO's 360-degree approach. Terrorism is our common concern, and we need to jointly address the most direct asymmetric threat to Allied security. A stable NATO southern neighborhood is also our immediate security interest. This is demonstrated by the fact that most of our military missions have been to Afghanistan, Africa, and the Middle East. The European Union is our partner, and the EU's efforts in the current situation are complementary to NATO. But NATO always plays an important role in driving innovation. And Estonia has been a very innovative country. So when I first learned that there is a DIANA Defense Innovation Accelerator, I definitely said that we have to be part of this. And I'm glad to say that Estonia, together with the UK, is set to create the DIANA European headquarters. The goal of DIANA, the NATO Startup Accelerator, is to support technology companies that contribute to defense. It will bring together talented innovators with new technologies, end users in the area of defense. And we, as we know from history, all the innovation made in defense can also be used in civil life later on. To conclude, our strength is our unity. Not only unity among our allies, but also unity within our societies. It will be vital to keep our unity in the months to come, and nobody is thinking that the months to come will be easy. The winter is going to be hard. We have to be prepared for that, but we can't be deterred from our decisions to support Ukraine and end the war. Over the next 2 days, you have a lot to discuss, and I wish you successful deliberations at this military committee conference. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister, for your inspiring words. We're honored for your presence here at the official opening. I would like to thank the media for being with us for this official opening, and at the end of today's conference, General Herem and I will brief the media on the outcomes of our discussions. Your Excellency, Madam Kallas, General Herem, and I will walk you out before we will return to the start of our first session today. Thank you very much.